12-year-old Garrett Phillips lived with his mother and half-brother in an old apartment building on Market Street in Potsdam, New York. Garrett's mother had recently ended her relationship with a local college soccer coach and moved her and the kids into their new place, and was happy to find it was just 5 blocks away from Garrett's school. In the small town, Tandy Cyrus felt her son was safe walking himself home from school, and he had a key to let himself into the apartment when he arrived there. After their move, Tandy alleged that her recent ex, Oral Hillary, known to his friends as Nick, entered the apartment multiple times without her permission, and that on at least one occasion, she awoke to find him entering her bedroom in the middle of the night. It was raining during the early evening of October 24th, 2011, when Tandy called her son Garrett after school and told him to get home and start on his homework. Surveillance cameras and eyewitnesses would track Garrett's short trip from the parking lot where he was playing basketball to his family's apartment building. Strangely, these same witnesses and cameras would also see a light blue SUV following him, very much like the one Nick Hillary drove. And Garrett would also be seen having a conversation on the sidewalk with Tandy's other ex-boyfriend, Sheriff's Deputy John Jones. Garrett arrived home at approximately 5 p.m., and within minutes, his across-the-hall neighbor was on the phone with 911, reporting sounds of a struggle and cries for help. By the time police gained entrance to the apartment, the young boy was found laying on the floor of the master bedroom, the victim of strangulation. He was rushed to the hospital, but passed away 2 hours after he had been attacked. His death was ruled a homicide, murder by asphyxiation. Immediately, police began poring over the apartment and found a damaged window, which they believed the attacker escaped out of, making a 20-foot leap to the ground. Sadly, the investigation would be full of missteps and errors which would ultimately result in several controversial actions, including deciding on a prime suspect within the first 24 hours, Tandy's ex-boyfriend, Nick Hillary. Despite a lack of physical evidence and witnesses, Hillary becomes the subject of several years of investigation. While the district attorney doesn't feel there's enough evidence to prosecute, a new up-and-coming candidate for the position promises to bring a trial in the murder of Garrett Phillips if elected. She succeeds, and 5 years after the murder of Garrett Phillips, Nick Hillary is charged with second-degree murder. Many argue that Hillary is being honed in on due to racist mindsets, Hillary being Jamaican, in the small town that has a 90% white population. The town itself becomes divided, with many standing beside Hillary, while others call him a murderer when they see him on the streets. Unfortunately, during the course of the trial, evidence is thrown out by the judge due to improper processing. The district attorney attempts to hide a witness, and it's been suggested that surveillance footage was altered. This comes amidst a flurry of accusations of misconduct on behalf of the new district attorney, Mary Rain. One of the prosecution's key witnesses is John Jones, Tandy Cyrus's ex-boyfriend, and for many, the other suspect in this murder. He had past issues with Hillary, and goes in-depth on his feelings about the man's tendencies, but he also has a history with Tandy, having written formal complaints that Jones had threatened her life and the lives of her children. She later recants, but now she feels Hillary is the man who is the real threat. The trial would only last 2 weeks before the judge would acquit Hillary on all charges, saying there was not enough evidence to prove his guilt beyond a reasonable doubt. Hillary becomes embroiled in a civil suit against the town and the police department for civil rights violations, while the end of the trial provides no answers and no justice for 12-year-old Garrett Smith, who now lays in Chapel Hill Cemetery. The town is divided, and Tandy is crushed, robbed of closure. She feels Hillary has gotten away with murder. But did he? Did Nick Hillary murder 12-year-old Garrett Smith in an attempt to get to Tandy, or because he blamed Garrett for their breakup? Did John Jones commit this heinous crime and, using his skills as a police officer, manage to frame Hillary for the crime? Or did a yet unknown suspect enter the apartment and murder Garrett on accident or for some still unknown reason? Join me as I navigate the twists and turns of this tragic story of murder, political one-upsmanship, and truth bent so far, it's hard to know which way is up. This is Trace Evidence, Episode 18, The Murder of Garrett Phillips. Welcome to Trace Evidence. I'm your host, Stephen Pacheco. Today's episode focuses on the tragic murder of 12-year-old Garrett Phillips, which took place in Potsdam, New York on October 24th, 2011. Before we move into the case, just a few notes about the show. Trace Evidence is a weekly true crime podcast focused on missing persons and unsolved murders. We are available across multiple platforms and we're on iTunes, Google Play Music, Stitcher, and many more. Trace Evidence has a Patreon for those of you who wish to support the podcast. It can be found at patreon.com/traceevidence. This podcast is a complete one-man operation and totally funded by me by myself, so if you enjoy it and wish to help support it, please check out the Patreon page. Links, information, and more items, including YouTube videos and full episode transcripts, can be found on the website at trace-evidence.com. If you'd like to contact me, you can email me at traceevidencepod@gmail.com. Tweet me at traceevpod, that's TRACEEVPOD, add me on Instagram at traceevidencepod, or join the Facebook discussion group simply by searching for Trace Evidence Podcast or clicking the direct link on our website. If you have questions, comments, or case suggestions, I'd love to hear from you. The podcast recently reached 250,000 downloads, and as a celebration of that, I'll be doing a second Q&A video where I answer listener questions. So if you have any questions about any topic, please send them to me via any of my social media accounts or email them to me. And as a final note, if you enjoy the show, please rate and review us on whatever app or platform you're listening on. The more ratings and reviews we get, the easier it becomes to find the podcast, and the more attention can be given to these cases. Today, I look into the murder of Garrett Phillips and the avalanche of controversy and political maneuvering which followed it. This is a disturbing case, which involves the death of a 12-year-old boy. Though I've avoided being too detailed in the descriptions of his injuries, I did want to give you a warning that this is about the murder of a young child, which to me makes it both grotesque and vastly important to cover. This is episode 18, The Murder of Garrett Phillips. Garrett Phillips was the first child of Tandy Cyrus and Robert Phillips, born on August 13, 1999, in Potsdam, New York. Potsdam is located upstate in St. Lawrence County, just an hour's drive from Canada. The small town has a population of over just 17,000, though during the school year, the combined students of the State University of New York at Potsdam and Clarkson University bring in an additional 8,000 temporary residents. Garrett's parents separated in 2001, when he was just 16 months old. Sadly, Garrett's father, Robert, would pass away in 2002 due to a brain aneurysm. Garrett was just 2 years old at the time. Garrett was described as a bright child who was always looking for fun and adventure. His mother would describe him as, quote, always happy, he loved everyone, end quote. She said he was full of energy and popular, always looking to do exciting things that were fast-paced. Garrett's fifth grade teacher, Lynn Tharrett, said he was, quote, well-liked by everyone, and that he was funny and the class clown, but very respectful, end quote. The general consensus seems to be that Garrett was intelligent, friendly, and very socially oriented with many friends. Garrett was described as fearless. He liked to tell jokes and run around with his friends. He enjoyed hunting and riding four-wheelers, and he loved sports. He also thoroughly enjoyed playing pranks and was known to be a prankster. Garrett's mother, Tandy, would become involved in several long-lasting relationships following her divorce. When Garrett was just 16 months old, she began dating Casey Collins. Tandy would become pregnant a second time, giving birth to Garrett's half-brother, Aaron. Tandy and Collins were together for 4 years, separating in 2006. According to Collins, he took on the role of father to Garrett during this period of time. Collins stated that Garrett called him dad even after the breakup, and later said, quote, I raised Garrett as my son, just as I did Aaron, end quote. A year later, in 2007, Tandy began a relationship with John Jones, a deputy working for the St. Lawrence County Sheriff's Department. The two would split up in 2010, but Jones seemed to have a great care and concern for Tandy and her children, specifically Garrett, who was older during the time they dated, and he felt their relationship developed well, stating, quote, I think we hit it off because we were both pretty sports oriented. Garrett was like, I want to play soccer. I want to play lacrosse. I want to play football. I want to play all the stuff. I want to play hockey because Jonesy plays hockey, which I thought was awesome. So that was the relationship I had. When he was around, I tried to be there for him in some form or fashion as a father figure. End quote. In 2010, Tandy met and began a relationship with Oral Nick Hillary, the head soccer coach at Clarkson University. They met while Tandy was tending bar at a local establishment called Tons. Hillary was separating from his wife and had three children, while Tandy was single with two children of her own. The two commiserated during late nights at the bar, while Hillary would complain about being in Potsdam, he was originally from Jamaica, and wanting to move to coach at a Division I school. Tandy was tired of Potsdam herself, and had dreams of raising her boys somewhere warmer and more metropolitan. After getting to know one another for a while, the two began dating, and then moved in together. Hillary moved in with his daughter, Shanna Kay, and was sometimes in custody of his boys, Elijah and Lashaka Mani. It was a tight situation in a small apartment, and Tandy's boys didn't warm to Hillary. Of Garrett's feelings about Hillary, teacher Lynn Tharrett stated, quote, Garrett didn't talk to me about personal issues, but he did tell me at least twice he did not like his mother's boyfriend, Nick Hillary, end quote. Of Hillary himself, Tharrett said, quote, he was polite when asking me questions, but I felt he was questioning my teaching methods, end quote. During this period, Tandy wasn't getting along with her ex, John Jones. In January of 2011, Tandy filed a complaint against her former boyfriend. In the complaint, she alleged that Jones had kicked her and her boys out of their shared home without notifying them as to why, and that later, quote, John sent threatening text messages to my cell phone as a means of intimidation, end quote. She further said that Jones was, quote, acting in various ways that caused me to fear for the safety of myself and my sons, end quote. Tandy would later recant this letter, claiming that Hillary forced her to write it due to his jealousy and possessive controlling personality. According to Tandy, Hillary had issues with Jones, most likely due to his past relationship with Tandy, and in October of 2010, he filed a complaint that Jones threatened him and that his car had been vandalized and he suspected Jones had done it. Tandy would say, quote, I can tell you that everything that was in the letter was complete BS. Never in my life have I ever been afraid of John Jones, end quote. She further stated, quote, Nick had a beef with Jonesy over what happened to his car, which had nothing to do with Jonesy. Do I wish I hadn't written the letter? Absolutely, end quote. The relationship began to take a darker turn, with Hillary taking more control. According to Tandy, Hillary would sit her down each week and scold her for the way she was raising her boys, telling her that if she didn't begin disciplining them, they would grow to be out of control. Tandy says that Garrett complained that Nick was too strict, threatening him and not allowing him the freedom he once had. While Hillary was away on a recruiting trip, Tandy sat down with her boys who complained about Nick and told her they didn't want him around. Considering the way the relationship had evolved, Tandy felt it wasn't in their best interest to live together anymore. Shortly after that, the decision was made that though they would continue dating, they should live in separate residences. Hillary helped Tandy and the boys move into a second-floor, three-bedroom apartment located in a nearly 100-year-old building at 100 Market Street in August of 2011, right around the time that Garrett turned 12. The details of what occurred after this are uncertain, but while the two lived separately, they continued their relationship for a short time before it eventually ended. The end of their relationship, though, did not bring an end to Hillary's behavior. According to Tandy, by September, she wanted a time away from Hillary and told him, quote, I needed some space, and Nick said okay, and he was going to leave me alone, end quote. Oddly, that night, while she was sleeping, Tandy was awoken by the sound of her bedroom door opening. She looked up and, quote, saw Nick standing there. I asked him what he was doing, and he said he was just going to sleep, end quote. After that, she asked for her apartment key back. Hillary would later state that he did not let himself into the apartment after their breakup, and that he had no additional copies of the keys, which he did return to her. According to Tandy's sister, on several occasions after the breakup, Hillary showed up at the apartment. He wanted to get back together. She stated, quote, Nick was very persistent about trying to get back with Tandy, He showed signs of wanting to be in control of her life, end quote. When asked about the details of the breakup, Tandy allegedly said that Hillary, quote, always blamed Garrett for our breakup, end quote. Hillary, however, when asked about Garrett, said, quote, all our interaction was positive, end quote. He went on to say his relationship with Tandy's 12-year-old son was wonderful and claimed that the reason for the separate living arrangements wasn't because of issues with the children, but because Garrett was being teased at school since his mother was dating a black man. For the next few weeks, things seemed to settle down. Hillary and Tandy had gone their separate ways. Tandy and the boys seemed to be doing well in their new apartment, and their future was beginning to seem hopeful. All of that would change in the late afternoon, early evening of October 24th, 2011. The events of that day are still hotly debated, but what cannot be argued is that after the tragedy of that day, Tandy, Hillary, and John Jones's lives would be permanently intertwined in a complex mess of finger-pointing, accusations, and legal proceedings. On October 24th, having not heard from her son yet, Tandy placed a call to Garrett's cell phone at approximately 4:30 p.m. He answered and said that he was playing basketball. Tandy told him to head home and get his homework started. Garrett left school on his skateboard at approximately 4:52 p.m., according to school surveillance cameras, and traveled 5 blocks to the apartment where he lived with his mom and brother. Garrett is presumed to have arrived home around 5 p.m. A few minutes later, Marissa Vogel and her fiancé, Sean Hall, who lived next door, heard some odd sounds. In a statement, Vogel said, quote, it sounded like something fell over. Something big. I've never heard a noise like that. It was like a heavy object falling onto the floor. About 5 to 10 seconds later, I heard an ow or a no come from across the hall. It sounded like one of the kids. I immediately heard the same voice yell, help. The help sounded like a moan, and I heard it more than once, maybe 3 times, end quote. Concerned for the safety of the children, Vogel went across the hall and knocked on the door. She would state, quote, I could hear faint movement near the door, and then I heard a click. My first thought was that someone just locked the door. We decided to call the police. Something didn't feel right about this, end quote. The 911 call came into the radio operator at approximately 5:07 p.m. Vogel looked out her window as she called the police to see if she could see any strange cars or suspicious people around, but there was nothing. After that, she heard nothing. She further said, quote, it was creepy. After the noises, I never heard anyone exit down the stairs. If they had, I would have heard it, end quote. Officer Mark Wentworth arrived on the scene around 10 minutes later and knocked on the apartment door for the first time at 5:17. He received no answer and knocked 2 more times at 5:24 and 5:35. He would later say that each time he knocked, he could hear soft footsteps in the apartment, but no one would come to the door. Remember, at this time, he's only responding to a call about weird noises from the apartment. According to his official statement, quote, I then heard what sounded like something falling. It was as if something was knocked off a table or fell off a shelf, end quote. Wentworth radioed in and got the building's maintenance man, Richard Dumas, and the two entered the apartment. The two saw the kitchen light was turned on. There was an article of clothing on the floor. Inside the master bedroom, they came upon Garrett, lying on the floor. Dumas later stated, quote, I ran to the threshold of the bedroom and looked in. It looked like he was sleeping, but his face looked dark, end quote. He was laying on his back with his head turned towards the door. His arms were at his sides, and his legs were close together. He was wearing a t-shirt and blue and white checkered shorts. Neither the room nor the apartment appeared to be disturbed or show any signs of a struggle. Wentworth noted that even the bedspread was neat and untouched. Of the condition of the apartment, Potsdam Police Chief Mark Murray would later state, quote, everything was clean. Nothing in the living room area was out of place. You could see that Garrett had neatly set his sneakers by the closet, his skateboard was neatly propped against the wall, his backpack was taken off. The only real signs of a struggle was his sweatshirt lying in the hallway and his physical body, end quote. Officer Wentworth got down on the floor and checked Garrett for a pulse and found one, though the boy wasn't breathing properly. He immediately radioed dispatch for paramedics and began conducting CPR. Dumas was present and said, quote, I kept telling him, come on, buddy, wake up, end quote. When paramedics arrived, they began life-saving measures while Wentworth began photographing the apartment. In another bedroom, Wentworth noticed something curious. The window appeared to be disturbed. The blinds were bent and the screen was partially popped outward. He theorized that the perpetrator may have pushed his way out of the window and jumped 20 feet down to make his escape. Chief Murray stated, quote, "We weren't sure what we had. We weren't thinking it was a homicide immediately, but something happened. You know, outlandish thoughts like, maybe Garrett fell out the window and made his way back up here, or an accident happened in the apartment and one of the kids don't want to get caught and get in trouble, so he went out the window. But when we looked at it closer, that's a remarkable jump from the window. It became clear that the only place to get in or out other than the front door was this window." End quote. It was also noted that there was a small dumpster below the window. Paramedics prepped Garrett, who at this point was suffering cardiac arrest, and rushed him to Canton-Potsdam Hospital. At approximately 5:30, Tandy was at the school gym watching Aaron's basketball practice. Suddenly, she saw her landlord enter the gym and approach her. He informed Tandy that Garrett was at the hospital and she needed to get there as soon as possible. She rushed to the hospital as fast as she could, assuming that Garrett had fallen or been injured, but she wasn't prepared for what the reality was. She arrived and saw that Garrett, quote, "had bruises on his face and marks on his neck. The doctor was talking to me, and I just remember him looking down over the tops of his glasses, telling me that there was nothing else they could do." End quote. Patricia Phillips, Garrett's grandmother, arrived at the hospital. She would later state, quote, "I went over to Garrett, and I bent down and I hugged him and told him to come home for grandma, and then he coded." End quote. Garrett was pronounced dead at 7:18 p.m. Tandy stayed at her son's bedside, saying later, quote, "I don't even know how long I was in there, until they came and told me I had to come out. I told him I loved him." End quote. Outside of family, many friends turned up at the hospital that night, including Tandy's ex-boyfriend, Sheriff's Deputy John Jones. Tandy still didn't know what had happened to Garrett. She was beside herself when she was informed that he had been strangled. State Police Forensic Identification Unit Senior Investigator Ricky J. Adragna began processing the scene. He found fingerprints on the windowsill and DNA evidence in the apartment, as well as DNA which would later be found under Garrett's fingernails. Police began canvassing the area. No one had seen or heard anything other than the neighbors who had called the police. There were some people outside changing a tire who reported hearing the sound of the screen being pushed out, but didn't see or hear anything else. Police immediately began to theorize the possibility that one of Tandy's ex-boyfriends may be responsible for the crime. They first went to Hillary's home approximately 2 hours after Garrett was pronounced dead, though they stated it wasn't to question him, but to inform him about Garrett's death, since up until recently, he had been involved as Garrett's surrogate father of sorts. According to Chief Murray, quote, "At that point in time, I had no reason to believe he was a suspect. It was more of a death notification capacity that we went and spoke to him at his house. I'm assuming if he was a father figure to this young boy, he would want to know something was wrong, something had happened, and that the boy had died." End quote. When asked about the first meeting with police and his reaction to the news, Hillary stated, quote, "First I was numbed, I mean, I was just at a loss for words." End quote. 2 days later, on October 26th, Hillary was brought in for questioning by the police. It appears that within the first 12 hours after the murder, Hillary was considered the prime suspect. Many people would look at this as a leap in logic, a decision made partially due to racism and based only on little more than speculation at the time. The investigation, at this point, would focus primarily on Hillary and ignore the possibility of other theories for the most part. Hillary was unaware that he was a suspect, but when he found out, he attempted to leave. At this point, he was given his Miranda rights and told he could not leave, though he would also not be arrested or charged at this time. Hillary requested a lawyer, which ended the questions, but according to Hillary, outside of being questioned, he was strip searched and his clothing as well as his phone were confiscated. He alleged that police provided him with a hazmat suit to go home in, having not notified him that they would need his clothing and he had nothing else to wear. Hillary was released 9 hours after being brought in for questioning. No arrest was made at the time, but Hillary got the distinct impression that he was being considered the prime suspect. They obtained his DNA and fingerprints from a cigarette butt and a coffee cup. According to police, one of the details about Hillary immediately following the murder which troubled them was that he was walking with a limp, one which they believe could have been caused by jumping out of the second floor window. The limp is enough for the Potsdam police to gain warrants to search Hillary's home and vehicle. The police reportedly asked Hillary to show them his ankle after he requested a lawyer, and also asked how he injured it. Hillary developed a groundswell of supporters, as well as a growing mass of detractors. According to a civil suit, which he filed against the Potsdam Police Department, he felt his, quote, standing in the community dramatically changed, end quote, and that his face became associated with Garrett's murder. He would later state, quote, I went from a father, soccer coach, and member of the community to, in the eyes of the public, a child murderer. My children were bullied in school. Threats against my physical safety became part of my everyday life. My home was egged, and people would openly scream murderer at me in public, end quote. Many also consider Hillary's position as a suspect to be due to racial bias. Potsdam's population was nearly 90% white at this time, with less than 3% of the remaining 10% being black. Police denied all allegations posed against them in the civil suit. Those who stood in defense of Hillary would point to another possible suspect, that being Sheriff's Deputy John Jones. Unlike Hillary, while Jones was spoken to about the case, he never felt he was considered a suspect. There came accusations that Jones wasn't asked to submit his DNA for testing, and that he couldn't prove his whereabouts that day. In response, Jones stated, quote, from day one, I gave everything voluntarily when I was asked, end quote. Jones claims he was questioned, and thoroughly so. Others have claimed that the police are covering up for one of their own, to which Jones said, quote, there is no way that the state police are going to cover up for a county deputy in the murder of a 12-year-old boy. It's not going to happen, end quote. Gregory E. Brown Jr., a convicted rapist, made a statement that he witnessed Jones entering the building behind Garrett that evening. Jones dismissed the claim as ridiculous, instead stating his strong feeling that Hillary was responsible for the crime. In regard to Hillary, Jones stated, quote, I feel confident and am putting my feelings aside from the victim and from the family, meaning Garrett's family, on both sides, that we have the right guy, without a doubt. He is our guy, he is the guy. There is no way there's anybody else. There's just no way, end quote. In response to questions about Hillary and Jones, Potsdam police constructed an official timeline of the movements of Hillary and Jones leading up to Garrett's murder. According to the timeline, at approximately 4:30 p.m., around 30 minutes before Garrett is attacked, Brian Phillips, Garrett's uncle, sees Hillary turning onto Market Street, the road that Garrett and his family lived on. At 4:43, witness Dale Rice sees Hillary heading south onto Leroy Street, then turning right onto Side Street. At 4:47, a light blue SUV resembling Hillary's pulls into the parking lot at Potsdam Central High School and sits by the tennis courts. It finally pulls into a parking space 4 minutes later at 4:51. At 4:52, John Jones arrives home. Garrett leaves Potsdam Central High School. The light blue SUV pulls out of its parking space, and Garrett walks past Canton-Potsdam Hospital on Cottage Street, heading towards Market Street. At 4:53, the SUV exits the parking lot, heading south, the same direction as Garrett, just 16 seconds after he passed by it. Hillary lived north from this location. At 5:07, Marissa Vogel calls 911, reporting strange noises in the apartment in which Garrett lives. Between 5:12 and 5:13, John Jones is seen walking his dog on surveillance camera, though it has been argued that the camera quality was poor and it's difficult to identify the individual's face. Officer Wentworth arrives on the scene at 5:17. At 5:21, Officer Wentworth calls dispatch asking for Rick Dumas, the building's maintenance man's phone number. Between 5:21 and 5:23, Hillary arrives at the home of his assistant coach, Ian Fairley, on Garden Street. Fairley says that Hillary appears and behaves normally. At 5:33, Officer Wentworth calls for EMS. At 5:34, Wentworth radios in that he has started CPR. At 5:53, the ambulance carrying Garrett arrives at the Canton-Potsdam Hospital. At 5:55, Hillary calls his lawyer. At 7:18, Garrett is officially pronounced dead. Several notes about the timeline. Tandy later admitted to driving by the apartment building and seeing a police car outside, though she didn't think it had anything to do with Garrett, and so she didn't stop. It should also be noted that there has been a report that a canine unit was brought in, and that it picked up a scent on the ground outside of the window, and followed it down Market Street to Washington Street and towards the railroad tracks. Hillary's residence, as well as his assistant coach's home, are in the opposite direction of those tracks. In addition to this, there's allegedly a section of surveillance footage which shows John Jones having a conversation with Garrett on the sidewalk outside of his home, which Garrett had to walk past to get to his apartment. The prosecution was later accused of tampering with the footage and blurring out this interaction. Later that same evening, Hillary had a soccer practice to attend. His soccer players reported a difference in his behavior, saying that he was easygoing and that was not his style. According to freshman Michael McDonald, Hillary, quote, "seemed on Monday that he was taking a step away, almost like he doesn't care anymore," end quote. Chief Murray attended Hillary's game the next day and made note that Hillary seemed to be walking with a distinct limp. Video footage was shot at the game, though upon viewing it, Hillary does not appear to have a limp. Police found it suspicious that a vehicle resembling Hillary's was seen in the area, and that he contacted his lawyer within an hour of the attack. Hillary counters this, stating that he's not just his lawyer, he's also a fellow Jamaican and former soccer teammate from St. Lawrence University. Hillary becomes their prime suspect, despite the fact that DNA and fingerprints found at the scene do not match him. Rumors begin circulating that Hillary murdered Garrett. The morning after the murder, Dan Manner, an investigator for the district attorney's office, calls Chief Murray and asks, quote, "does the mother have a boyfriend?" end quote. He then explains that his granddaughter heard a rumor that the boyfriend committed the murder. Chief Murray responded, quote, "yeah, that's the rumor," end quote. Interestingly, just over 12 hours after the murder, we have an investigator for the DA and the chief of police discussing a potential suspect based on little more than an unfounded rumor. Weeks, then months, pass with little movement on the case. In Tandy's mind, Nick becomes more and more likely to be the man responsible for the death of her son. When asked about it, Tandy states, quote, "when I put everything together, Nick's actions, before and after, I think he was very possessive and controlling. When we broke up, Nick told me my kids were making my decisions for me. Nick always blamed Garrett for our breakup. I can't think of any other person who would want to hurt Garrett," end quote. Despite the growing tension in the town and strong beliefs on both sides, nothing yet happened. Then, nearly a year after the murder, in September of 2012, Hillary filed a civil suit against the village and police officers. His suit alleged that his civil rights had been violated, that he had been detained, and his property was seized and searched without a warrant. Several years passed, and the investigation remained active, but District Attorney Nicole Duvay would never bring charges against Hillary nor anyone else. In 2013, during the race for St. Lawrence District Attorney, challenger Mary Rain built a platform that if elected, she would bring the case to trial. Tandy got firmly behind her, campaigning for her and being active on social media in support of her. The next spring, just 5 months after winning the election, Rain brought the case and evidence before a grand jury. Rain stated, quote, "the generalities are, Nick was dating Garrett's mom. Nick did not want to split up. They'd been split up for about 2 months when he killed Garrett," end quote. Judge Jerome Richards wrote in a summary of the grand jury testimony, in which he stated the jury was, quote, "invited to conclude that the defendant took out his frustrations over the relationship with the mother by picking on the victim," end quote. On May 15th, 2014, Hillary was indicted on second-degree murder charges, to which he responded, quote, "I am 100% innocent. That's all I have to say," end quote. Almost immediately, Hillary was fired from his job at Clarkson. Later, in October, the charges were dismissed due to an over-reliance on circumstantial evidence and that the inclusion of video evidence lacked adequate foundation. Judge Richards accused District Attorney Rain of bullying Hillary's daughter, Shanna Kay, who provides the alibi for her father. According to this alibi, If the crime is truly to have taken place between 4:56 and 5:30 p.m., he was at the home of his assistant coach for part of the time, and at his home with his daughter for the rest of the time. The problem with the alibi is, Shanna Kay claims she had dinner with her father around 5:30, but in subpoenaed phone records, there's a text from Shanna Kay's phone sent to her father at approximately 6:20, in which she asks, "What's for dinner?" The prosecution argued against the timeline, stating that the location of Hillary's assistant coach's home, Hillary's home, and Garrett's apartment are all within a mile of each other, offering plenty of time to be in all three places. However, John Jones, the man many point to as a potential suspect, also lived within a block of Potsdam Central High School and directly across the street from Canton-Potsdam Hospital. Garrett's apartment building was located just around the corner from Jones's. Rain was not deterred, and instead of appealing the dismissal, she brought her case before a new grand jury, and Hillary was indicted, this time in January of 2015. Much of the prosecution's case rested on a new type of DNA analysis known as STR mix. This analysis was developed in Australia and New Zealand, and replaced typical DNA analysis with a complex software that uses mathematical modeling to construct statistical analyses of mixed DNA profiles. Unfortunately, for District Attorney Mary Rain, the judge threw out this evidence. In a 10-page decision, the judge concurred that the STR mix analysis was dependable and verifiable, but he stated the problem lay elsewhere. According to the judge, the state laboratory that collected the DNA samples was not approved as reliable in collecting samples for the new STR mix analysis. That forced John Buckleton to use other reliable sources to help frame the data, which he admitted was not an optimum practice. On Wednesday, September 21st, 2016, Oral Nick Hillary was acquitted on charges of second-degree murder. It was argued that the prosecution had provided little hard evidence. No fingerprint matches, no hair or fiber samples, no DNA, no witnesses placing Hillary at the scene of the crime. The trial was a non-jury trial and lasted 2 weeks. Judge Felix J. Catena found that there was not enough evidence to prove beyond a reasonable doubt that Hillary was responsible for the crime. Tandy slumped in her seat and cried at the announcement. The prosecution made several missteps during the trial, including an attempt to conceal a witness who claimed to have seen John Jones entering Garrett's building on the day of the attack. Despite the results of the trial, District Attorney Rain remains convinced that Hillary is the man responsible. In a statement given to the press, Rain said, quote, "He's the one who did it. Just because he was found not guilty doesn't mean he's innocent," end quote. When the judge's decision was announced, there was an explosion of outbursts in the courtroom, including that of Brian Phillips, Garrett's uncle, who shouted, quote, "Karma will get you," end quote. In an interview following the acquittal, Hillary stated, quote, "I've been exonerated by the judicial system. I mean, that should be enough, one would think. But people will forever be humans, and there's not much more convincing you could do," end quote. A 12-year-old boy was murdered for no reason, and 6 years later, the prime suspect was acquitted, to the joy of many and the dismay of others. There are three main theories which revolve around this sad and tragic case. The first theory is that, despite his acquittal, Oral Nick Hillary is responsible for the murder of Garrett Phillips. Theory suggests that Hillary was angry at Garrett and held him responsible for the breakup of his relationship with Tandy. They point to the witnesses and surveillance footage which noted a vehicle similar to Hillary stalking Garrett that afternoon and following him home. Many have theorized that Hillary kept a copy of his key to the apartment with which he let himself in and that he confronted Garrett. Some people have speculated that Hillary had only planned to hurt Garrett or maybe even just threaten him, but in a rage, things got out of control and he murdered him. After that, the neighbor knocked on the door and he knew he couldn't go out that way. So he jumped from the window, injuring his leg, and had his daughter, Shanna Kay, perjure herself by constructing an alibi for him. Despite the fingerprints and DNA not matching, many still believe that Hillary is the killer, especially Garrett's family. The second theory is that Sheriff's Deputy John Jones murdered Garrett, and that not only did he commit the crime, but he was protected in a cover-up conducted by the police department, who attempted to railroad Hillary and use racial tensions to sway the public's opinion in favor of their theory. Motive seems to be somewhat lacking in this theory, though many believe that Jones had a grudge against both Hillary and Tandy, and that his attack on Garrett was designed to hurt both of them. Why he would choose to murder Garrett isn't clearly defined, though many believe murder wasn't his intent. Of course, in his case, there are also the details that the DNA and fingerprints found at the scene do not match him. An interesting note, though, is that while Hillary did not have a key that police could ever prove, John Jones did in fact possess a key to Tandy's apartment, which he provided to police during their investigation. The final theory is that someone other than any known suspect was responsible for the murder of Garrett Phillips. When you factor in the unmatched fingerprints and DNA, it seems hard to place the blame on the shoulders of either Jones or Hillary. A motive behind this crime is hard to pin down, though many believe that the murder was either accidental or incidental. Someone may have been in the home with the intention of robbery or something else, and was startled by the arrival of Garrett and wanted to silence him, but went too far and killed him. Unfortunately, if this was a crime committed by a yet unknown suspect, considering the passage of years and the lack of investigative work to find him or her, this person has a massive head start. There was also some discussion early on that the crime may have been committed by a friend of Garrett's who was roughhousing with him and things got out of hand, but other than an offhanded remark by the police chief, little else has ever been suggested about this. The murder of Garrett Phillips is a heart-wrenching story. An innocent young boy was murdered, and for no reason at all. The investigation's focus on one particular suspect, regardless of whether or not people believe he was guilty, severely limited the scope of possibilities, and therefore made it unlikely that Garrett would receive justice. His mother and brother have gone forward without him, without answers, and without closure. Potsdam itself remains split on who they believe was responsible, and with the acquittal of Hillary, the answers have only grown more mysterious. Garrett Phillips was laid to rest at Chapel Hill Cemetery. There have been memorial activities such as charity kickball games and balloon releases done to honor his memory. There's even a memorial park with a monument dedicated to him. Regardless of the outcome of the trial, this is still an active case with the district attorney's office, as well as the family, still firmly behind the belief that Hillary murdered Garrett. Whether or not an answer is found, and a suspect can be matched to the DNA and fingerprints, remains to be seen. And until that day, the murder of Garrett Phillips remains unsolved. Hey guys, before getting into the theories on this case, I wanted to take a moment to tell you about Corpus Delicti, a true crime podcast hosted by two women that I personally think are pretty awesome. Rather than explaining it, I'll let them tell you about it themselves.
Hey y'all, Jen and Lindsay here from the Corpus Delicti podcast, here to tell you to check out our show.
If true crime's your thing, it's ours too. Just a little dash of lightheartedness and a hint of southern charm.
Serial killers, controversial cases, historical hallmarks, we've got it all.
So just join us every Tuesday on iTunes, Podbean, or many other podcast apps as we dive into compelling cases and crack them open for you.
You can also find us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. That's CorpusDelicti.
See you Tuesday.
The murder of Garrett Phillips is a really sad story. The idea that a 12-year-old boy had his life stolen from him is just heartbreaking. His future was taken away, and so were the futures of several other people involved in this tragedy, including his family, who still have no answers and cannot fathom how someone could commit such a cowardly crime. I'm always moved by stories of crimes committed against children, and this story has bothered me since the first day I read about it. I first learned of this case a few years ago, and followed news updates on it. There's a couple of things about it which have always bothered me, and it's one of those cases where there's evidence on one side pointing one way, and yet the direction of police and prosecutors tends to go the opposite. It's one of the few cases where I can easily see both sides of the story. The authorities' point of view makes sense in many ways, but not in others, while Hillary's defense made sense in many ways, but not in others. It's exceedingly frustrating to have a wealth of evidence but no real way to apply it. I've read that there were as many as 140 DNA samples taken from the home on the day of the murder. This is a case so chock full of information, I couldn't report it all without making this a 3-hour long episode. In my research, I did my best to include what is most pertinent to the story and to give perspectives from all sides. There's been a lot of talk that the drive behind the arrest of Nick Hillary was race-based, and although I'd like to believe that's untrue, I can't exactly present an argument against it either. It would hardly be the first time someone was cornered and pressed as a suspect based on a racial bias. There were arguments on both sides of the case, with many people believing that Hillary was guilty, regardless of a lack of evidence, and especially early on when there was very little information available. Tandy firmly believes Hillary was responsible. Others aren't so sure. The district attorney certainly considers Hillary to be responsible, even after his acquittal. This has been a difficult case to research for a multitude of reasons. Firstly, there's a lot of information about the events leading up to the crime, and then everything after that becomes about the legal proceedings, and it's difficult to find much information about the actual investigation. Beyond that, the theories are fairly limited in that they essentially follow that Hillary did it, Jones did it, or somebody else did it. There wasn't much related to a theory that was proposed beyond that. The final, and most important reason, is the fact that the facts in this case are difficult to trust. When you have the prosecution hiding witnesses, allegedly suppressing video footage, and ignoring the lack of matches for DNA and fingerprints, it's hard to know which facts are pure and which facts have been manipulated in some way. The final thing I wanted to address before examining the case and theories was some of the controversy surrounding District Attorney Mary Rain. There's been a lot of accusations of misconduct, fraud, and improper action swirling around her position since she was sworn in. There are a lot of newspaper articles discussing her actions and choices, which many have been critical of. There was an instance where Rain allowed one of her interns to prosecute a felony case without a law license. When it came to the case of Garrett Phillips, Rain was accused of misconduct during the grand jury for her treatment of a witness, and she failed to disclose a possible witness to a man entering the building the day Garrett was murdered. Suffice it to say, there's a lot of talk surrounding her time as district attorney. Former Chief Assistant District Attorney Frank Cacciatore resigned in November of 2016, writing a scathing letter in which he accused Rain of being negligent in her duties and said she had a, quote, willingness to throw victims to the wind when it's convenient, end quote. He also said, quote, it's my regret that so many young attorneys have had their careers ruined while working under you in this county, end quote. I just thought it was important to discuss these details and perhaps put into perspective the system as it was in place at the time of this crime. Almost everything we know about the murder of Garrett Phillips comes from surveillance camera footage and a timeline that the police constructed, even though specific details of the timeline itself are disputed. The 40 minutes or so surrounding Garrett's death are fairly well fleshed out. We know that Garrett received a call from his mother telling him to go home and start his homework. Following that, he walked and skateboarded home from school, where he was playing basketball. Sometime after he arrived home, everything went wrong. He made it into his apartment untouched, which is confirmed by the fact that he had taken off his shoes and leaned his skateboard against the wall. At this point, someone either gained entry to his apartment or revealed him or herself from a hiding place and was already inside the apartment. The across-the-hall neighbor, Marissa Vogel, hears disturbing sounds, and when she knocks on the door, she hears something which indicates to her that someone's inside. Then she hears the door lock. She stays pretty perceptive of the situation while she calls 911, and according to her, no one exited the apartment building via the front door. Police arrive, but they're only dealing with a noise disturbance, so rather than breaking in, the first officer on the scene knocks a few times and eventually gets the building maintenance man to let him in for what is essentially a wellness check. Upon entering, the officer and the maintenance man find the apartment in perfect condition other than a sweater on the floor in the hallway. In the master bedroom, they find Garrett's body on the floor. He has a pulse, but is in distress. A call is placed to emergency medical services who arrive, prep Garrett, and rush him to the hospital just down the street. Just over 2 hours after the initial attack, Garrett is pronounced dead. His family is there, and they're in shock over what could have happened to him. Police search the apartment and surrounding areas, they photograph the scene, and bring in a forensic team. Damage to a window screen tips them off that the perpetrator bent the screen outward and jumped 20 feet down to escape. A forensic sweep of the apartment picks up many different samples of DNA and finds fingerprints on the windowsill. To this day, those fingerprints and DNA samples have never been matched to anyone. Within 24 hours of the crime, Nick Hillary is focused on as the prime suspect, and from there on out begins several years of back and forth, investigation, political moves, and poor decisions, which ultimately lead to a trial in which Hillary is acquitted based on a lack of evidence. So what exactly happened to Garrett Phillips, and who was responsible? The first theory I'd like to address is that the crime was committed by Tandy's ex-boyfriend, Sheriff's Deputy John Jones. We know that following their breakup, Jones had several negative interactions with her new boyfriend, Oral Hillary. On one of those occasions, Hillary claims that Jones threatened to kill him, while Jones says he simply asked Hillary what his problem was and whether or not he wanted to settle it like men. Hillary filed a complaint, and that same day his vehicle was vandalized with obscenities being painted on it, which he blames Jones for. Tandy would file a complaint against Jones later, alleging that he threatened her and her children with violence. She would later recant this complaint, saying that Hillary forced her to do so. Could things have gotten so bad that Jones decided he was going to hurt Garrett and then things got out of control and he ended up killing him? Maybe. But there are problems with the Jones theory as much as there are problems with the Hillary theory. It's been reported that on the day of the crime, Jones is seen on surveillance footage outside of his house just around the corner from Garrett's apartment, talking to Garrett on the sidewalk. We don't know what was said, but there was an interaction here, even though it does not exist on the official timeline of events. Jones is alibied because surveillance footage shows him walking his dog, but the footage isn't clear, and it's honestly difficult to get a positive identification here. Jones had a key to the apartment, and we know this because during the investigation he provided it to authorities. This means he had access to the home and could have gotten in without making a fuss. Everything that could suggest Jones could have gotten in and committed this crime is highly circumstantial, but where I find this theory really lacking is in motive. Perhaps something was said between he and Garrett that made him angry, or maybe he wanted to get back at Tandy or to frame Hillary. These are speculations surrounding his possible involvement. The problem is, there's really nothing to support it. Jones was never seriously looked at as a suspect, but he has said that he provided investigators with everything they wanted, which I'm led to believe includes fingerprints and DNA. We know that the fingerprints and the DNA found in the apartment that day were never matched. Also, Jones was on the scene at the hospital to support the family and even drove Tandy down to the police station the next day to make a statement and discuss the case. If in fact he committed this crime, those are some ballsy actions. Jones had a good relationship with Garrett, and it seems unlikely to me that he was going to take his anger out on him. As we see in his confrontation with Hillary, he's much more likely to go to the source. There's almost nothing which links him to the case, other than the fact that he's one of Tandy's ex-boyfriends and the statement of a convicted rapist who claimed to see a man resembling Jones entering the apartment building that day. Not the most reliable sources, but still a claim which should have probably been investigated further than it was at the time. The family doesn't believe he was involved, and neither does the prosecution. I do think he should have been looked at more closely at the time, but short of new evidence or something which can more strongly connect him, I just can't say that he's the one who murdered Garrett Phillips. The second theory is that Garrett Phillips was murdered by someone who is yet unknown. Perhaps someone who planned to enter the home and rob it, although there were no signs of forced entry and no hints that the apartment had been ransacked in any way whatsoever. Perhaps someone who had run into Garrett on the stairs up to the second floor, or who had followed him home from school, although nothing is seen on surveillance footage to suggest this. It seems most likely that when Garrett arrived home that day, whoever was responsible for this crime was already inside the apartment. We know that the screen of a window was popped out, and police viewed it as a likely escape lane, but could it have also been an entrance? Maybe. We're talking 20 feet up, but a perpetrator could have climbed. The ultimate question is why, and what was the motive? It seems too specific to be a random attack, and it also seems like Garrett's death may have been accidental. Obviously, if you strangle someone, it takes quite a while to kill them. It isn't like the movies, it isn't a 30-second thing. But do we really know what happened? Is it possible that someone in the apartment choked him or grabbed him and put their arm around his throat in order to silence him and it went too far? It's all possible, and it's all speculative. The evidence suggests that the murder was committed by a yet unidentified party because the fingerprints and DNA have never been matched, and that a police canine unit picked up a scent and followed it from the window to the railroad tracks. If I'm going to be black and white on the evidence, if I'm going to rule out circumstantial details, rumors, and speculation, then all I really have to go on is what limited physical evidence we have, the DNA and fingerprints. They did not match any of the named suspects, and to me, this suggests that the crime was most likely committed by someone police have either chosen not to identify, or more likely, someone who they don't know the identity of. What's fascinating is that since there are no hits on the DNA or fingerprints, it was likely someone who doesn't have a criminal record. There is a subsect to this theory, and one which I believe should be considered. During an interview, Police Chief Murray put forward the theory that, originally, they thought it was possible that Garrett may have been killed accidentally by a friend or another boy or girl with whom he was playing and things got out of control. This is certainly a possibility, though I think the apartment would have been in much more of a mess if this was the case, and a 20-foot leap from an apartment window would almost certainly have injured a child, but it does have to be considered a possibility. I chose to file this under unknown suspects theory, and there's very little to go on here, but it's impossible to rule this out at this particular time. It would also explain fingerprints and DNA not being in the system as a child, unless it's one who's been arrested, is unlikely to show up in the system to be matched. Whether or not any of Garrett's friends were ever questioned or considered, I don't know, but considering the tunnel vision on Hillary, I somehow doubt it. The last theory is the one which authorities ran with, that Hillary murdered Garrett Phillips. In support of this theory are several pieces of information which the police used to build their case against him. First, we have the accusations from Garrett's mother, Tandy, that Hillary was a controlling man who had on multiple occasions entered her apartment without permission and held Garrett responsible for the end of their relationship. Let me preface this by saying that I am in no way accusing Tandy of anything here, but this wasn't the first time she made public statements about an ex-boyfriend which ended up not being true. In relation to John Jones, she filed complaints against him for threats of violence and stalking, though she would later recant and claim Hillary forced her to do so. Also, Garrett was murdered shortly after their relationship ended, and this would hardly be the first time that one member of a relationship had terrible things to say about their ex later on. Couple that with the fact that police chose Hillary as a suspect within the first 24 hours, and she was likely asked about him. It isn't hard to imagine that in her desperation for wanting justice for her son, she would have had negative things to say about him, which may have drawn police's attention to him even more so. What's important to note is that, despite all of the claims she makes about Hillary's behavior, at no point does she point to or suggest anything violent. Hillary was controlling, and Hillary would get angry, but as far as we know, he was never physically violent with her or her children. That isn't to say that he couldn't have committed the crime, and that in a moment of heat, he didn't become violent. Perhaps he had a more calm and cool personality, and was able to premeditate this murder, but it's a large leap to make, especially after several weeks. So, police go to speak to Hillary and notify him of the death, because he'd lived with the family up until recently. This is strange to me also. He wasn't a relative, so I don't know why they would perform a death notification with him. I do believe they went there because they likely asked Tandy, who she thought could have done this, and his name was said. That's speculation on my part, but it doesn't make sense to me any other way. The limp comes into play here, and we're told that either an officer on the night of the murder or the chief of police who went to a soccer game the next day notices a distinct limp on Hillary, which they relate to the 20-foot drop from the apartment window. The problem is, no one else notices the limp. The video, which was shot by police at the soccer game, is alleged to show a significant limp, but from what I've seen, there's not much of a limp, if any limp at all. There's no indication that anything is wrong with Hillary in the footage. The supposed limp is what will gain the police warrants to take Hillary's clothing and search his vehicle and apartment. Now, there's been some conversation that, during his 9-hour interrogation, which takes place 2 days after the murder, that Hillary admits to an ankle injury, but relates it to something else. If indeed his ankle was injured, that could certainly be enough for police to take a closer look at him, especially considering his former relationship. In addition to this, police question the students he's coaching and make note of the fact that they all said his behavior was different from the night of the murder. The problem is, that's all the police say. When you look into it closer, his behavior wasn't different in a way that he was angry or seemed withdrawn or troubled. They all said he seemed more carefree, less strict, and happier than usual. It's difficult to imagine someone being happy and lighthearted after murdering a child, but stranger things have happened. According to the investigation, surveillance footage shows Hillary's light blue SUV stalking Garrett in the minutes leading up to his murder. In fact, the SUV parks at the high school, and 16 seconds after Garrett passes by, the vehicle exits and heads in his direction. If true, this is damning evidence. The problem I've seen with this is, I've seen nothing which concludes with the certainty that it was Hillary's vehicle. No confirmation of the license plate, no video footage of him behind the wheel. Now, I admit it's quite a stretch that there would be another vehicle identical to his doing this and that Hillary would have injured an ankle the same day, but as far as evidence goes, we still don't have a completely concrete foundation. When you add in that testing shows the fingerprints and DNA found in the apartment did not match Hillary, you've got a real problem with this suspect. Now, some argument could be made that the fingerprints weren't left behind by the perpetrator. We don't know if there had been any repairmen in the apartment in recent days, and it is an apartment that they've only lived in for 2 months, so the fingerprints could have been from someone viewing the apartment or any number of individuals. The problem comes with the DNA, and we know some was found under Garrett's fingernails, and that doesn't match Hillary either. So what do they really have, outside of statements of Tandy, surveillance camera footage which may or may not show him, and a debatable limp? Nothing, really. Hillary claims that due to his travels that night, he couldn't have been responsible. His assistant coach is a witness to the fact that he was there at his home between 5:20 and 5:30, approximately 20 to 30 minutes after the attack. That's a short drive from Garrett's apartment, but the assistant coach notices nothing wrong with Hillary, no limp, and states that he seems calm and normal. The next witness is Hillary's daughter, who places him at home for dinner. Interestingly, the state does find a text which shows that his daughter texted him well after 6 p.m. asking what was for dinner, and that does seem to contradict her story. So, where was Hillary around this time? We don't know. He calls his lawyer later in the night, but he's also close friends with his lawyer, so it's hard to look at that as a particularly leading piece of evidence either. Hillary was found to not be in possession of a key to the apartment either, despite exhaustive search efforts. I can completely understand how the Potsdam police would have connected all of this circumstantial evidence and found Hillary to be a strong suspect. However, they have an obligation to construct more than that, and for 2 years, no charges were filed against Hillary. I believe that's because the previous district attorney knew there wasn't enough evidence to get a conviction, and it's only after the election of Mary Rain that charges are filed. Interestingly, Hillary was charged with second-degree murder, which would suggest that the crime was not premeditated, which I find fascinating, considering that some of their evidence suggests that Hillary stalked Garrett that day. I would have to speculate that they believe Hillary murdered Garrett, but that perhaps his intention was to do him bodily harm and not to commit a full-on murder. A huge piece of me sees the authorities' side in this, and finds it hard to believe that all of this could be coincidence. A possible ankle injury, the same vehicle following Garrett, the call to the lawyer, an alleged problem with Garrett. It seems like a lot of pieces of the story that connect Hillary to the crime. On the other side of the coin, no fingerprint match, no DNA match, no history of violence, no witnesses put him at the scene, can't really tell if it's him on the surveillance video. The case revolving around Hillary is remarkably frustrating, but I have to agree with the original district attorney who was in charge. Even if he is responsible, the police are not currently in possession of enough evidence to make those charges stick. I think Hillary is still a possibility, but the more I read about this case, the less I feel secure in that belief. To me, whoever committed this crime was either someone that Garrett trusted and he allowed inside the apartment that day, or someone who had a way to gain access and was there waiting, possibly not even for Garrett, maybe for Tandy, and Garrett became a victim of wrong place, wrong time. It's an extremely sad and disturbing story. A 12-year-old boy lost his life, and 6 years later, we've got no answers. John Jones had his reputation damaged by accusations. Nick Hillary will forever be labeled a murderer whether or not he was responsible. Tandy lost her son, and can't achieve closure until the responsible person is found. In the years since, she's come back up and been active in campaigning for justice for her son, but for several years, she lingered in a dark place with her life collapsing around her. Aaron, his little brother, is now older than Garrett was when he was murdered. Life moves forward slowly for all those involved, and the town of Potsdam is split on what exactly happened and who's responsible. There is evidence in the possession of the police, and someday we may get a match. But short of that, or a new break in the case, or the unlikelihood of a confession, we may never know the answers, and we may never find out what happened and what kind of monster could murder a 12-year-old boy in his own home. Garrett's life was taken for no reason, and due to investigative errors and decisions made based more around politics than justice, we are all left in the dark. The murder of Garrett Phillips is one of the most disturbing cases I've covered, and unfortunately, it remains unsolved. If you're interested in finding more information about the murder of Garrett Phillips, there are a lot of websites you can look at. 2020 did a special on it, and it's rumored that Investigation Discovery is going to do a special on it. If you have any information about the murder of Garrett Phillips, please contact the Potsdam Police Department, the FBI, or your local police. Who do you believe murdered Garrett Phillips? Tweet me at TraceEvPod, email me at TraceEvidencePod@gmail.com, or comment in the Facebook group. I want to thank you for listening to this episode of Trace Evidence, and invite you to check out the website at trace-evidence.com. You can find links to the Patreon, all social media accounts, as well as places to download and subscribe to the podcast. I'm always eager to hear your feedback, so if you enjoyed this episode, please give us a good rating on iTunes and leave us a review. This will greatly help our reach and bring more attention to the cases we cover. Don't forget, I'm doing a special Q&A video soon, so hit me with your questions, and I'll be happy to answer them. A quick shout out to the ladies from Corpus Delicti, as well as Ariel Jane of Murder Under the Midnight Sun, for helping keep me sane while I research this difficult episode. Thanks for listening, and I hope you'll join us next week for another unsolved case on the next episode of Trace Evidence.